very excited. Unlike the Today Show, I don't have to go back to work today, so this is great for me. A bit of background about myself. My name is Jasmine Wright. I currently teach in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. I've been teaching for 7 years. I've taught in multiple states in the U.S. I've also had the privilege and the opportunity to explore international education in other countries as well. And I also taught GED. Currently, I am starting a nonprofit. It's called the Push Through Organization, and it was actually inspired from my students in that video we created that went viral. But that's not why I'm here today. That's the background. So I'm here today to speak to you, or to try to motivate you, on a topic called change. According to Webster's, change is defined as to make or become different. Change is a very heavy, multifaceted kind of word, right? It has physical application as well as intrinsic application, right? There's change externally around you, and then you have to internalize the change and try to figure things out from there. With that being said, change can either, depending on the person and how it's perceived, it can either make you confused, or can lead you to a new sense of understanding, right? Change can either make you really happy, or really sad, or really excited, or can intimidate you and make you afraid, or make you worried. Today, my goal is to try to convince you to consider choosing change. I'm going to be briefly, in about 15 minutes, speaking to you about the benefits of change and the rewards associated with it. I want to start with this brief quote. It says, it takes a deep commitment to change and an even deeper commitment to grow. Now, as I saw this quote, me being a teacher, right, I'm very creative with the metaphors of the stories, I immediately thought of a story about a pizza delivery driver. Random, work with me, right? So imagine you're home. Your favorite day of the week is Thursday. You're home on your Thursday evening, you're wearing your favorite pair of pajamas because they're very comfortable. You're watching your favorite TV show that comes on every Thursday night at 8 o'clock. You're eating your favorite snack, drinking your favorite beverage, whatever that may be. Okay, your favorite song is playing in the background. You are comfortable. This is something that you're used to, that you do every single Thursday, right? And then, all of a sudden, here goes, that's a knock, by the way. There's this knock at your door. And there's this pizza delivery driver ordering you a pizza with a topping of change. And so you say to this pizza delivery driver, excuse me, sir, I didn't order any pizza change today. I'm watching TV. This is something that I do every Thursday. How dare you come in and interrupt my me time, something that I'm comfortable with. So pizza delivery driver says, is this 123 memory lane? Is this the address 123 memory lane? You're like, yes, sir, this is 123 memory lane. So pizza delivery driver barges on in into your home, your comfort zone, right? And he says, you need to pay for this pizza because it's the law of pizza world for you to pay for pizza when we knock on your door. So you're upset. And instead of you going back and forth with the delivery driver, in order to get him out of your way, you try to offer him cash, or excuse me, your card, so that the pizza delivery driver can leave. But that's what we do with change. We try to briefly just try to address it without fully committing to it. So the pizza delivery driver notices that you're not really invested in this pizza. He says to you, we don't take card. We actually accept cash. We only take cash. So now you're inconvenienced even more by this change, right? And so you finally, you go to the store, you get cash just for you to come back and notice that your TV show has changed to a new show. He changed the radio from your favorite music, and you're like, what is this change delivery driver doing, and why is he in my home taking over my space? And your belief and your mindset, you view that change as something negative, as something that's barging into your personal space, as something that is unwanted. But like I tell my children, I don't have any children, like I tell my students, how you perceive it is how you will believe it. And how you believe it is how you'll receive it. Now, granted, my students are 9 years old, so it took us a while to actually know what that means. So my purpose of saying that was, imagine the delivery driver knocking on your door. And this time, as he or she knocks on your door, you have both cash and you have card ready. Because as leaders with change, we have to know that we have to be ready at all times for the unexpected. He comes in your door, and this time, instead of you getting upset when he or she changes the channel, right? You're more so, you're watching what he's changing to, and so now you're exposed to a new TV show that you've never seen before. That's what change does. It exposes you to something new, right? You're learning about a new station that you never even knew existed on your 65 channels of Comcast Network. I have 65 channels. And he changes your radio station, and you're listening to a brand new song or a brand new genre of music that you never knew existed. So now you're exposed to a new culture. You're learning a new language, because in this song, they're singing in Spanish, because that's what change does. It exposes you to something new, and it can have many positive rewards associated with it. Being a school teacher, change is very, very, very common in my classroom. And actually, I have a very, this time, more realistic story associated with change. This is my first year at my current school in Philadelphia. It's my first year at this school. It's also my first time learning this content for this particular school. It's also my first time teaching this grade. So it's my first time for everything. I taught this lesson, I forgot what it was about. I just know that lesson was horrible. Right? It was horrible. I'm being completely honest. I'm so glad I didn't get observed that day from my administrator, because it was horrible. I didn't understand it. I didn't know how to explain it. And as a result of me being the leader of that room, my students then also acted off on my confusion. They were confused. They started behaving and misbehaving. It got to the point where it was so bad that I shut everything down. I shut everything down, and I had a conversation with my students. We had a debrief, and we spoke about what could we have done better to master this lesson, right? What could we have done better to get the most out of this new lesson? Now, me teaching 9-year-olds and 8-year-olds, you know, they rose their hand and they said, he shouldn't kick me next time, or she shouldn't take my pencil. And so I said, okay, I'm the leader of the classroom. I'll lead by example, right? So I raised my hand and I told them, I said, let me give you an example of something that Miss Wright could have done better to accept this new change. Miss Wright could have explained and presented the material to you differently so that you could have understood. Miss Wright could have been a little bit more patient with you when you were confused about something, because I also know that this is new for you too. So once I started opening that door of all the things I should have done differently, my students, they began to get it and they began to catch on. So they started giving me examples of things they should have changed about their behavior and how they did the lesson. And so I thought I led the best debrief conversation ever. Like, I thought I nipped that in the bud. And so I asked the children, I said, okay, so raise your hand if you believe that you could have done things a bit differently during this lesson. And everybody raised their hand except for this one student. Because we know as leaders, or as people over a group of others, there's always that one person. And so I said, well, mate, we're going to call him John Doe, by the way, for confidentiality purposes. So his name is John. So I said, okay, well, maybe John Doe didn't understand my question. Let me rephrase it. I said, okay, so how many of us believe that there are some behaviors that we have that can be changed so that we can do better with mastering this new lesson? And lo and behold, everyone raised their hand except for who? John Doe. This is a true story, by the way. So I spoke with John Doe after class, and I asked him, I said, Johnny, I realized you didn't raise your hand. Why didn't you raise your hand when I asked those questions? And he said to me, Miss Wright, I don't want to change. I like who I am. I said, that's interesting. I said, I love who you are as well. You're a great young man, but I'm still confused. You don't think that there's anything that you can possibly get better at or get stronger at so that you can be a better young man? He said, Miss Wright, I like the way I am. I don't want to change. He was stern. I said, John, how old are you? He said, 8. I said, okay, so next year, you'll be how old? He said, 9. I said, okay. I said, so your birthday is in December, right? He said, yes. I said, what comes before December? He said, November. I said, okay. I said, when you woke up, it was what part of the day? He said, morning. I said, when you go to sleep, it'll be what part of the day? He said, night. I said, we're getting somewhere. I said, when you put a seed into the ground, what does it turn into? He said, a flower. I said, well, John, I'm confused. You seem to be surrounded by so much change. There's so much change around you, yet you desire to stay the same. I don't get it. Don't you want to keep up with the Joneses? Don't you want to keep up with everyone else? And then he started thinking, because I always know how to get them right there, right? So he started thinking. I said, so I want to ask you again, John. You know, I want to know the real answer. What is it? What do you think prevented you from doing your best on this lesson? And he said to me, he said, Ms. Wright, I didn't understand it. I didn't get it. I said, oh, it makes sense now. He said, I didn't understand it, and I didn't get it. So what I got from that was, you're afraid of change. You're afraid of being uncomfortable. You're afraid to leave your comfort zone. So you were so afraid of learning this new material that you resorted back to your old ways. That you resorted back to your old ways of misbehaving because you were afraid to tackle this new change. And I said to him, I said, Johnny, do you know that you're in second grade? And we're in third grade. I taught second grade last year, sorry. That you're in third grade and that there are going to be tons and tons of changes in third grade. You're going to have to learn a brand new set of skills. There are going to be some things that are going to confuse you. There are going to be some things that are going to make you feel afraid, but we have to push through. And we have to believe in ourselves so that we can conquer them, so that you can grow up and you can be a great Johnny, daddy, and man in this world. Young man, you have to be comfortable with change. And it took us a while. I'd be a lie if I told you right then and there that Johnny understood what I said. And I'd be a liar if I told you that the next day Johnny was an angel in my classroom. He was the top performing students. I'd be a liar. That's because change takes time. Change takes time. Internalizing change takes time. As long as you're cognizant of being better. I told Johnny that change is inevitable. But your progress in my classroom or your progress as a young man in this world is optional. Change is going to pursue you hard. Change is aggressive. It's going to come whether you're young, whether you're old. It's indifferent of skin color. It's indifferent of profession, of socioeconomic status. Change is going to always be there knocking on your door, delivering you pizza, right? And you have to be receptive of this change. If not, you'll never grow. I told Johnny, I'm so glad for all of the things that were new and introduced to me in my life because it allowed me to be a better Miss Wright. I met new people from change. I learned new skills from change. I learned how to do new things. I was exposed to this change. And as I said before, how you perceive it is how you'll believe it. And how you believe it is how you receive it. I'm going to show you something real quick. Many of you have probably seen it before. It's a quick, like, 20-second video, and it shows you a video of a train that's moving in one direction. In your mind, it's going in a direction, one single direction, whichever direction you choose, either left or it's going right. But if you stare at it hard enough and you convince yourself that you can change the direction of this train, you'll realize that it will go in the opposite direction. Can we run that clip? Response person. I'm sorry in advance, but that's really what it is. The change of that train or the change in life is going to happen whether you like it or not. But you can have a positive or a negative response or reaction to it based on how you receive it. Because your progress as a person is optional. This is a quote that I wrote. It's very long. I hate a bunch of words on a slide, but I felt as if it was really pertinent for this situation. So it says, situations change, minds change, settings change. Perspective shift, rule shift, day shift. Age grows, trees grow, height grows. Inventions develop, thoughts develop, skills develop. Seasons rotate, hairstyles rotate, clothes rotate. Movies end, time ends, levels end. Technology adjusts, friends adjust, feelings adjust. Yet in a world filled with so much change, you desire your comfort level to stay the same. Do not cheat yourself out of your growth. This is what I tried to get Johnny, or John Doe, as well as all of the other students in my classroom to understand. You are filled and you are surrounded by change, and change can be uncomfortable, change can be unwelcoming, change can also be hard, but I promise you that there are great things that come from it if you want it. Closing out, I like to close out with a way of attacking or a way of perceiving or reaping the benefits of change. So I found this online. This one is not my idea. I will not take credit for it, but you consider change in two things. Either it's a barrier or it's a belief. Now, both of these things have positive outcomes, right? They're very positive, meaning that there's a way to perceive change where it can promote your progress as an individual. If there's a barrier is something that's physical, a change that's physical, like a physical barrier, then you can find strategies to overcome that change so that you can develop or so that you can excel as a worker. If the change is a belief, we're going to go to an example in a second. If the change is a belief or something that you think, well, the thing to get over that is you should just think of a more empowering or a more stimulating thought, which can alter your perception on change. So I'm going to give two quick examples, and the objective of this is to acknowledge the potential barriers and process them in a way that leads to our confidence and our ability to overcome them. I'm going to present a brief situation, right? A brief scenario. I wasn't sitting in on your earlier session, so I am unsure of the change that is going in your organization, but I was told that there is some change. So imagine the situation, right? It says my team and I are already comfortable with how things are working in our department. This change going on will divide us, right? That's you talking to your coworkers. In order to think of a more positive thought, you have to ask yourself, is this change a barrier or is it a belief? Right? And if you think that this change is a barrier, something physical, okay. But raise your hand if you believe this change to be a belief, something that you're thinking. Oh, I love crowd participation. Excellent. It's a belief. It's a belief because it's a thought. Right? It's not something that's tangible, that's really true. It's how you're feeling. So in order for us to get over this problem in our brain of change so that we can receive it and be better leaders, we have to think a different and more empowering thought. Maybe a thought such as, change is inevitable, and this will help us gain new skills. We will grow stronger together, figuring them out as a team. Thoughts such as these can trickle down to our employees, or in my case, to our students. To help them also, because thoughts and positivity is contagious, but that's a whole different story. We're not going to get on that topic. I can preach on it. It says there will be a change in measuring success. Within your organization, there's going to be a change in how success is measured. Is that a belief? Is it a barrier? I can understand the confusion in this. I kind of made these speeds up. I am unsure of the changes going on intramurally in your organization, but I labeled this one as a barrier because it's something that's true, that's visible, that there's a change in how our success is measured. That's common for me in my school system. A strategy to get over that would be, I need to learn how to do things the new way so my team and I can be successful. The commonality with both the belief and the barrier is all up here. Because how you perceive it is how you'll believe it. Come on now. How you perceive it is how you'll believe it, and how you believe it is how you'll receive it. How you perceive it is how you'll
believe it.
And how you believe it is how you'll
receive it.
Excellent. So that's the closing for me. I just want you to consider choosing change. Think about all of the rewards, all of the maximizing of a growth of skills that can come along with choosing change. And I promise you I can't promise you everything will be all right. But I can promise you. I thought that was a good closing. But I can promise you that you'll feel a bit more positive and a bit more accepting of the changes that's going on. Thank you.